University.
Thank you. Thank you, SNI, for inviting me. And really pleased to speak with you here today. I'm going to say with no wrong modesty, my lesson on neuroscience and cognitive arousal through I spent 25 years on the board with my choice doing treatment and health services research on history and public policy. It's not quite anything. It's due to microbiscuity problem like Brian Kitson, who co-lead neurosurgery with me to support you with SNI. I want to talk about the essential trying to take care of people like the student neuroscience and science fears that I think I really understand reasonably well, which is addiction and public policy. And that's the answer. My title for policy is not enough.
And I'm president of Cure PSD, and we're thrilled to have our new associates in Canada, and this is the first and critically important step to having a global presence for Cure PSD. Promote our future conferences. You will be asked before we use any photography, you will be given a print, set a print release, and you'll need to give your permission to use that photography before we use it. But the purpose is to try to promote these conferences to a broader audience. And thirdly, there is a quiet room available for everyone. It's down the hall. It's all here in the Monarch Room. And down the hall on your left, I'm sure you'll be fine. Welcome to go there anytime. Anyone needs a break. So without further ado, I'm pleased to introduce Mary Ellen Duncan, who is the Vice President of the Board of Directors of Cure PSV Canada. And we're thrilled to have her. Mary Ellen.
Good morning, everybody. I met some of you last night. It was fun to get to know you. First, I would like to introduce our new directors of PSV Canada. As I said, I think five wonderful ladies that have given their time, lots of effort, and lots of work. And hopefully, we will get many volunteers that can help us, because this is a hard job. We want to get out to as many people as we can, because it's so important that we learn and help other people with PSV, MSA, and CBG. So first, I would like to introduce MJ. You want to stand up, MJ, please? Come on. MJ is our president. She is also the support leader of our Kingston branch of our caregivers and families. There's Karen. She's also from Kingston. There's Debbie from Ottawa. And Kimberly from Toronto. And of course, there's our ever-loving Trish. She's our adopted Canadian now. She worked with us and she's been on our backs for months trying to help us learn about PSV, trying to get the name of PSV, and try to get as many people to this conference as we could. And it's so wonderful that such a wonderful turnout today. Sure gives us hope that we can succeed in passing this message on in Canada and in the world, because it's so important. We do need volunteers. Anybody who would like to volunteer to help us in any city, possibly start a support group. MJ and all of us on the board of directors would only be too happy to help you. We now have business cards. We can all give you business cards with our email addresses and everything on it, so you can get in touch with us. We now have a direct toll-free 800 number or 888 number, and you can get in touch with us that way. That phone goes into MJ's house, not mine. Now, there's going to be merchandise. It's still out in the hallway if anybody's interested in purchasing something of it. It's really beautiful. It's all been customized for Canada. It has a little maple leaf down the bottom and most of the sales. And that's absolutely wonderful. They've done a wonderful job in the state doing all of this merchandise, all of this imprint material for us in Canada. I can't thank Dave and his crew there for having us all done. Thanks. Now, last night, I was at your meeting, and for those who were here, saw the hope there. I don't know if anybody's ever heard of hope. If you're on Facebook and you see the PSCA logo, hope belongs to the PSCA group. This belongs to a gentleman in Scotland. His daughter bought it for comfort for him, and he decided that he would like to send the bear around the world. And it has been from Scotland to Pennsylvania, from Pennsylvania to Mount Vernon, New York. And when I called in at Mount Vernon, New York, I emailed and asked if I could have it in Canada. Because I thought it would be fun to bring it to the meeting, and so you people could see if possibly we could do this in Canada some different way, and have you read in the journal. There's a journal here that everybody that's seen the bear sort of puts back on their responses and the stories of their loved ones. I have written about my husband Bob, a lot of you met, and also in line I have put a thing about our conference, so they know that we've had a conference in Canada, the first ever. And I would like to pass it on to someone today. I would love for some people to sign the book, and also let me take a picture of them so I can send it to the gentleman in Scotland, because he's going to the Parliament of Scotland on the 17th to try to get more help in Scotland for people with PSV. So this is hope. We do have hope that somehow we'll find a cure, and I hope that you all will enjoy the conference and you will get some information that you possibly didn't know and it'll help us in the future. Thank you very much. There's a little table over in the corner here. This is Monique's table. She's here to help you. If you have any health issues or anything like that, she does work with that and will help you if you need financial support. Just talk to her and get some forms from her. She's done wonderful for tax credit for people with disabilities. And if you're interested, just give her a talk. Go talk to her. She'll give you a business card if you don't have time today, and maybe give her a call another time. She goes right across Canada, and she'll be glad to help you. Monique and her girls. Thank you.
It is wonderful to see this turn out this morning. Thank you all for being here. You know, we'll have some interplay in terms of how we say things, in terms of you're teaching me how to say OUT again. So a little bit of my background. I'm a neurologist. I do predominantly movement disorders and muscle sclerosis. Basically, I'm a neurologist who deals with chronic diseases of the nervous system. And I started, I was born in England, in Oxford, spent my formative years in Canada, and have been in the U.S. since 1972. On the other hand, Kathy, who I met in Wisconsin, has been with me on that journey in every step, and continues to work with me in our center. So, that's who I basically am. But now, this is not the first time that I had members of my family have been here testifying or talking about. So, the Senate of Canada, Special Committee on Science Policy, isn't Committee on Rich Politicians Committed with Sin or whatever. They asked the Special Committee on Science, and the witness was Arthur Porter, Department of Industrial Engineering, Acting Director, Center of Culture and Technology at UOC. That was the Dad was testifying in 1968. That was the Committee on Science, and that's the forum. Yeah, he's in your forum, and that is where we have all the
Recent article in movement disorders
sort of cast some doubt on this. But where you see the white matter, it sort of takes you out of thinking in the PSP line, because white matter disease and gray matter disease are different things. So all of this makes it difficult. And then and these are pathological things that I won't cover. So PSP symptoms are loss of balance, development of visual symptoms, usually described as blurring. And I'm going to get to that later in terms of, because this is the phenomenon where your eyes don't work and you go to the eye doctor, and the eye doctor puts your eye in his machine and he looks and he says, your eyes are 20/20. I can't figure out why you can't see. Your eyes are 20/20. We'll get to that. Development of personality change, irritability, being argumentative, sort of difficult things to tell, you know, in terms of the age group that we occupy, and that these are kind of life diseases. Developments of light intolerance, persistent squinting, and negligence. So, CBCD, on the other hand, is a phenomenon that begins on one side, typically in the upper extremity. I have a delightful gentleman I have followed now for a couple of years who had it. It began in his foot, and it has now progressed to involve the entire left side. It actually began in his foot, and he was, after seeing four neurologists in North Carolina, he was eventually included in Duke. He was eventually seen at Mayo Clinic in Jacksonville, where the diagnosis was made, and I have followed him subsequent to that time. So, development of balance walking difficulty, progressive development of a speech disorder. So that's where people will get the idea that these people have multiple mini strokes and cognitive and speech disorder. So then if you then look, then you make things even more complicated. So you look at progressive supranuclear palsy and you look at multi-system atrophy and how do they differ. And I know this year falls loss of balance, rigidity. We talked about that before. Difficulties with personality change, difficulties with cognitive impairment. Sleep disorder we see in multi-system atrophy, and we have this loss of autonomic regulation, which is not really a part of PSP. And the loss of autonomic regulation, we have always doctors like things where we can measure. We love things that you can measure. You can measure cholesterol, you can measure blood pressure. But actually, the loss of autonomic regulation is something that is more difficult to measure. And it is interesting that we find it now that more reliably that these people have intermittent fevers, that their legs are going to sense. And that's part of the issue that they have with the falls and balance. So, I apologize for this slide. I'm going to blow it up. But basically, what we are saying, the Lexi analysis from autopsy data that was published relatively recently. This included data from the Brain Bank at Mayo down in Jacksonville. It also included data from the Brain Bank at University of Saskatchewan. Allie Rice was the long-term neurologist at Saskatchewan, and I have a great fondness for Saskatchewan. I spent my middle school years in Saskatchewan when my dad was the engineering there. So when I see Royal Hospital, I pay attention. But if you look at this latency here in terms of diagnosis, clinical diagnosis, 4.9 years, 2.7 years, 5 years, 3.2 years, 4 years, depending upon the type. So this is a huge in terms of delay. And again, this slide does not show particularly well, but this is a time chart here where the disease duration is on the bottom line here, and the number of patients is on the vertical axis. And so as you can see, as time passes, 1 out to 10 years, progressively increases the number of people with the gaze problem. Progressively increases the number with the movement problem. Progressively increases the number with frontal dysfunction that implies difficulties with thinking and behavioral change. Difficulties with swallowing. Difficulties with falls. I see the falls rapidly going up. Difficulties with tremor going up. Not going up a bit, but then staying very stable. Upwards. You would see with Parkinson's disease. Cognitive impairment, again, progressively increasing. And then death. A phenomenon that then, as you go through the course of the disease, the mortality rate progressively increases. So what do we have currently in terms of symptomatic treatment? So levodopa is this is the 50th year that we have levodopa for Parkinson's disease. Levodopa is for Parkinson's disease. What insulin is to diabetes. And that's another probably the greatest piece of Canadian science ever is advancing and discovery of insulin in 1921, advancing and this. So levodopa for Parkinson's varies, and it's useful. You can think about levodopa exactly the same way for Parkinson's as we think about insulin for diabetes. Does it cure the disease? No. But it does replace a chemical, a neurotransmitter that is absent. And so when we start talking about neurological treatments, it's modifying effects rather than going to the beginning. I'm going to get to that. But so other things that we can do is I think you will remember, is the vision thing and switching and light intolerance. So we can use botulinum toxin for the eyes, and that is an injection of Botox or one of the other licensed products. Now there are three of them around the eyelids. And you do get a improvement in at least the lid squinting for a period of about 3 months. And when it's done by somebody who's experienced and who's skilled, it's very worthwhile. But it's something you may have to ask for, because it is not something that every neurologist who is a movement disorder specialist is necessarily comfortable in doing. As I have said, my opponent, some of the drugs we use for spasticity, they help the muscle rigidity. It's highly variable. My opponent is what we use on patient drugs called Temperance or Lexarenzium. They study on Telentime-2, and everybody asks about it. But the standard dosage that you get at the health food store is not particularly potent. We're talking about big doses to have any effect. And so you're talking of the order of $400 about to get into a therapeutic dosage range. Northera is a drug that came out last August and was introduced by Lundbeck. This is not a drug for PSP. This is a drug for the autonomic, the symptoms of blood pressure regulation in MSA. This is multi-system atrophy. This is a drug that we are just getting our feet wet with. And it's certainly true that there are some people where it's feeling remarkable change in life quality. I'm not sure what his status is in Canada in terms of whether it's gone through approval. Yet. I suspect it probably has. So now that I've got you this work, this is the clinical basis. So what do these diseases look like? And why are these diseases different than single multiple sclerosis? So here is an MRI of an 18-year-old neurologically normal college freshman. So you say, oh, you know, why do you Americans get an MRI on an 18-year-old neurologically normal college freshman? Well, because her dad had a meningioma, and that is the type of brain tumor, and she had new onset headaches, and there is some inherited tendencies towards that, which is why this was done. This is an interesting MRI from the standpoint. It shows the beautiful differentiation between the gray matter on the outside and then the white matter tracts. And the white matter tracts in the human brain are hugely important. This is what differentiates us from other mammals, is that the white matter, it has heavy protein codes, and that heavy protein code translates into speed. So the white matter translates into computer speed. It translates into speed and bandwidth. And if any computer guru will tell you, we need speed and we need bandwidth in order to have the word problem. So here you see that actually in this young lady, the frontal white matter doesn't show, it's not completely tungstenized yet. In other words, the brain is still developing at the age of 18. And it's those frontal lobes that give you the check reflex, which is accounts for the fact that teenagers will not infrequently engage mouth before brain is really clear. Okay, so now this is the traditional picture. Now I want you to just bear that picture of that normal brain in mind, okay? Look at these central structures, look at the cerebellum, look at the brain stem here, and look at this upper portion of the brain stem. And if you spend a couple minutes looking at this, can you all see sort of the bird here? Do you see the bird in the middle? Okay, the beak, the breast, you know, you can see it. And you can see my essential tremor. And you can see the cerebellum. Hold on. All right. Then, this is a traditional picture of what TSP looks like. So what do you see? Well, you see, this is now different. This is now shrunken. And these midline structures here, the corpus callosum, you can see this is all thinned out. And you can see, generally, that the brain volume has gone down. However, in clinical practice, bearing that one, which is a typical one that I just showed you, that's the one in the books. Now you look at one, this is one of my patients. And so, do you see, actually, in this instance, as much in the way of change in the upper midbrain as you saw there? No, it looks more like the normal, doesn't it? But yet, up here, it looks very similar.
Thank you. Easter for a year.
Thank you.
So to that end, this is a work-related thing, but so how does it apply to me and my job?
So there's this guy I talk to occasionally, Penn, named Neil Doshi. He's a McKinsey guy. And basically what they've done is in their studies, they've actually looked at direct and indirect motives of motivation, intrinsic motivation. And what they say is, stuff on the left is good, stuff on the right is not so good. So one of the stuff on the left, less of the stuff on the right. So what do these things mean? Potential is your potential. It's the story of you, okay? The idea is that if you think about your job at work or your career school, you're here because you think about how am I going to become better as a person, going to Stanford, studying whatever I'm studying, this is part of my journey, and everything I'm doing is for that larger vision. That's all the axis of potential. And it's a good thing, and good communication, good motivation design, things like that, revolve mostly around the axis of potential.